So a couple weeks ago, I was having a conversation with another YouTuber named Levi Hildebrandt, and he asked me one question. Is minimalism dead? And my answer was yes. You see, over the past decade, minimalism has had a good run. There were the blogs, the reality TV shows, and endless jokes about downsizing your kids. Minimalism feeds dominated Instagram. BuzzFeed listicles about how to streamline your home went viral. Dinner conversations centered around which spoons sparked the most joy. Oh, and how could I forget? Viral videos from handsome YouTubers. But minimalism wasn't without its critics. There were plenty of opinion piece takedowns and people who thought that it was only a way for white rich people to complain about how difficult it is to own so much stuff. Minimalism seemed to come out of nowhere to inspire millions of people to take a closer look at the things in their lives, to discover how to be more intentional with our homes, how to be more mindful about our spending. And we even learned how to properly fold our socks. It seemed like everyone, from bloggers to global brands, had something to say about minimalism until one day they didn't. It's cliche to say, but things are always changing. And when it comes to minimalism, there's no exception. If you look back over the past decade, you can see that minimalism as a trend is starting to run its course. You can see that minimalism had a lot of relevance during the early heydays of blogging back in 2004. Then there was a big spike in 2016 after we released our first documentary, which is kind of crazy to think about. But since then, the popularity has slowly started to taper off. There was a time back when I first started on YouTube when you could use the word minimalism, throw it into the title of a video, and guarantee that you would get a ton of views. But that's not the case anymore. The question that you might be asking yourself is, does that mean that minimalism is no longer relevant and it's going to go the way of Tamagotchis and yo-yos? Not quite. To understand what's happening with minimalism, you need to understand how trends start, become widespread, and sometimes fade. In his best-selling book, The Tipping Point, Malcolm Gladwell argues that in order for any trend, idea, or social behavior to become a phenomenon, you need three key ingredients. A few influential people. He calls this the law of the few. A sticky message that people can easily remember and understand. This is the stickiness factor. And the power of context. Basically, an idea has to happen at the right place and the right time. One of the simplest examples from his book covers the explosive and confusing trend of hush puppies in the 90s. If you don't know, hush puppies were a suede shoe that was super popular in the 50s and 60s. By the time the 90s rolled around, they were a joke. But when a few hipster kids from Manhattan started to wear hush puppies again, literally because nobody else wanted them, it kicked off a massive frenzy, a huge trend, and millions of shoes were sold. But why did this trend kick off so quickly? And what does this have to do with minimalism? Well, going back to the three rules of epidemic trends, we can see exactly what happened. First, those hipster kids in New York were social, hip to vintage styles, and influential. This was the law of the few. Hush puppies were also instantly recognizable and memorable when people saw them on the street. That's the stickiness factor. And finally, the nostalgia of 50s and 60s shoes were just happening to peak at this time, thanks to stuff like swing dancing and vintage revival trends.
What a comfortable shoe.
Jeff Lewis, who worked for a company that owned Hush Puppies, said, "A geek chic thing was happening, and the shoes fit right in. It was a perfect storm that spawned a massive trend." Now think back to the early days of the minimalist movement. Seemingly out of nowhere, a few influential bloggers started to write about this lifestyle called minimalism. Blogs like Zen Habits, Be More With Less, and The Minimalists wrote early essays that reached tens of thousands and eventually hundreds of thousands of readers. The message itself? When we stop buying crap that we don't need and get more intentional with our decisions, we can lead more meaningful lives. In other words, less is more. It doesn't get much stickier than that. That made the message easy to remember and share. Gladwell writes, "There is a simple way to package information that, under the right circumstances, makes it irresistible." And the final ingredient? The timing. The rally drum of the past 70 years has been more, more, more. As packed malls made way for one-click shopping, goods became cheaper to make, and advertisers spent billions of dollars to sell them. And things were going well for a lot of people, until they weren't.
now it's official, we are in a recession.
The global financial crisis hit in 2008, and people lost their homes and entire life savings overnight.
This could be the most serious recession in decades. And that means life, as most Americans know it, is about to change.
So many people all over the world started to question whether more really was the answer. Luckily, there were a few bloggers out there to steer them in the right direction. So if minimalism is so transformative, if it really helps people live more intentional, fulfilled lives, then why is it beginning to fade? And the easiest answer is because that's what all movements do, even the important ones. Every trend has a cycle, and minimalism is beginning to fade because it's reaching market saturation. Basically, almost everybody knows what minimalism is today, and so it's just being talked about less. It's being more accepted into society as a whole. And so, of course, as we've mentioned, as a trend, it's beginning to lose steam. There are plenty of trends that continue to help people live happier and healthier lives. They're just not front page news anymore. When something first catches on, it's natural that everyone and their mother is gonna wanna give it a shot. And not everyone is gonna be a fan right away, if ever. For instance, yoga has been around for thousands of years but reached the tipping point in the US in the 1970s. The same thing happened with jogging.
I believe it's jogging or yogging. It might be a soft J. Apparently you just run for an extended period of time.
But just because these fitness trends reached peak popularity decades ago doesn't mean that they're still not valuable practices today. When people first started running around their neighborhoods and stretching for fun, it was weird. But today, yoga and jogging are almost boring because most people have accepted that they're just good ways to live a healthier life. So what's the difference between the trends that stick around and those that only have a moment in the sun? It comes down to one thing. Is there long-lasting value in the practice itself? In other words, does it actually help people, or was it just a bunch of hype? And only time will tell whether any trend will actually continue to outlive and outlast its peak popularity. But when it comes to minimalism, I think you already know how I feel about it. While the trend is starting to fade, I do think that it will be here for the long run. As long as people struggle to find meaning in their lives, as long as massive companies funnel billions of dollars into trying to solve our human needs with physical products, as long as we continue to trade immediate gratification for short-term rewards, minimalism will have a place. In the next decade to come, we'll probably use the word minimalism less and less, but as long as the problem remains, we will need a solution. And so I'm excited to see, now that minimalism has gone mainstream, how do we take this conversation even deeper? I'm excited to see the creators who will be talking about it in creative and thoughtful ways, challenging people to push against the status quo. And hey, maybe that person is you. If you're the kind of person that nerds out about self-development, then you'll love the newsletter I just launched called Snail Mail. Every Monday, start your week with an original article and a collection of the best self-development content on the internet. Here's what people are saying about it. I couldn't put it down because of how interesting the topics were. It was so much more than I expected it to be. I think it's going to be the next trending newsletter on the internet. Snail Mail is so f***ing good. Get practical and actionable advice delivered directly to your inbox at slowgrowth.com/newsletter. You can click the little link in the description below to sign up today. And that right there was my best attempt at a sticky message. Let me know down in the comments if I was successful or if I failed epically. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.